But we are so fortunate to have Dan Sturges here. We all know that mobility and traffic is a major, major concern here in Culver City and throughout Southern California, particularly here on the west side. And as many of you know, we are expecting up to 10,000 more jobs in our community over the next 3 years or so. So mobility is going to become more and more of an issue. And we have a bit of a jump on it, that we've been thinking about it for a while, but all the solutions really are going to be necessary for us to be able to work on this and to get it to where we can get around without having just one person in one car clogging up the roadways that take up to 25% of our city. So, you know, taking back our streets for ourselves for different types of mobility is what today is all about. But Dan Sturges has been a visionary in this field for decades. So it really is amazing to have him here. He has been a transportation designer and theorist, and the extraordinary thing about Dan is that he's a practitioner. He has actually, you know, designed modes of transportation in the industry, as well as I can't help going back to the word visionary intellectual on this, but he has not been, he would be very welcome in the halls of academia, but that's not where he has spent, certainly most of his career. He's actually been out there where the rubber hits the road, designing these things that make us able to get around and really being a spokesman for it. So, you know, if he was to tell us about his career, we would see the trajectory of design for transportation, what it's looked like over the decades, and where it's headed. So if anybody can help us come up with these solutions that are beyond what we've considered before, it's Dan Sturges. So, Dan, welcome. So delighted to have you here.
Hi, everyone. Is that on? I think I know there are a number of you here, so that's awesome. People still like me. This is my presentation about creating a master plan to really improve Culver City, and my canvas is pretty much LA County. I mean, that's where I think it's important to work. But yeah, we live on this planet, and it's a pretty trippy thing, and we don't have a lot of time to think about how amazing it is because we're struggling to go anywhere in our cities. And we're getting our cars to go somewhere, but they maybe are not taking us where we really want to go. So I think that this is a time we need a new way of thinking about how to solve these problems. Traditional, like you can go to the car design world, and they're in their own silo. You can go to the public transit world, and they're in their own silo. Now there's Uber and Lyft in their own silo. We need to think more holistically and more creatively how we're going to solve these problems. So LA2B is a name that the city tried really never got much traction yet, but it's a fun name. My name is DanMan, simple to remember. So we're in this process of going from really an automobile culture, I'll call it an automobile monoculture, to a future that's mixed modal. And this is going to take some work to get there, but this presentation will address that. I lived in LA off and on since 1983. I know how awesome so much of it is. There's creativity everywhere. There's amazing destinations. There's the ocean, the beaches. There's this amazing weather. It's just this amazing thing. But I think transportation has got to be the one thing that I don't know anyone really loves of Los Angeles. And when you sit in traffic going 10 miles an hour, just remember, we are the most advanced technically we've ever been as humans. And we're somehow struggling. So it's really not the technology that can solve this for us. It's really part of the psychology. And Los Angeles really is a form of restricted mobility now. Any of you live in Culver City, if I was in Santa Barbara Friday night at 4:30 and I called, you say, come on up to Santa Barbara for dinner. You would say, no, I can't do that, because I have a restricted transportation system. And then we have our new spokesperson for the climate and the environment, and we as humans have been abusing the environment for so many years. And climate change is so important. But, you know, when we're talking about recycling our straws, look what's happening on the streets. And there's so much to deal with that. And here's my first quiz for the day. When you, a gallon of gas weighs 6 pounds. When it goes through your engine, it's burned and it becomes CO2 and other stuff. Even though that other stuff's invisible, it has a weight to it. Does anyone know how much your gallon of gas weighs when it comes out the exhaust pipe? 20 pounds. And then, to also get our gasoline, you know, we go and are not nice people on the other side of the planet. And this picture I'm going to show you is from Life magazine. It's really tragic. It's a little boy that lost his arms and was burned, and his aunt hasn't told him yet that his family's dead. And about, I think now, about 10 cents of every dollar is going to this guy in a country that's got an oppressive country. And more or less in LA, you're car locked. You're locked to your one car. That is what you got. And so we know that the AAA figure for a car is $8,500 a year if it's a newer car. People all say, oh, that's too much, that's not real. But it's everything of your car, including the depreciation. So for a house with two cars, it's $50 a day. So if the car dealer came to your house every night and wanted $50 for two cars, or your cars had like a when you put, you know, like dollar bills into the vending machine, if you had to put a $20 bill and a $5 bill to start your car every day, you would start realizing it's a pretty expensive way to get around. And then we also have in LA devoted about half the land to cars and transportation. That's an older picture, so it's not quite as bad. But it's bad. And last year they said there's no solution to this. So this is the end of my presentation. I stop here. But they were talking to these people in these individual silos who haven't figured out how to work together more creatively yet, in my opinion. And the thing is we don't even have to leave the planet to imagine a better world. We can go over to Copenhagen, where 50% of the people bike. And to me, for people in LA, the most remarkable thing about that is they do it in the snow. But in Los Angeles, 2%. So with all this going on, the fact you can't, you have restricted mobility, you can't move well, it's hurting the environment, the carbon emissions, getting gasoline from bad places on the other side of the earth, to the cost of your pocketbook, and there's not many places to bike, I guess, to feel safe biking or something, but it's not working. I mean, it's really, this city needs a reboot of mobility. Now, the public transit here is good. I mean, these people work hard. When my career stalled out in 2010, I drove a bus for 6 months. I know what it's like to drive a bus. They work really hard to get the light rail and the buses and do all this stuff. And, you know, it's getting better because now you have a phone that'll take you across this crazy map, because nobody's going to give up their car for that map. But the problem with it is no matter how well they do their bus system here or light rail system, it's slow. And like when I lived in Culver City a few years ago, I took my bike to the train, to the other train, and biked in Long Beach, and the whole trip took me 2.5 hours one way. So if we're trying to get people out of cars, and we're trying to get people on the train, now I wouldn't want to propose any of the solutions I have without a good metro system, and the metro system should be better. But thinking that the metro system is the only alternative to the car is not going to get us there. So we have this new reality. We essentially live in a global city now. I can send a book in a PDF format to New York in 1 second. We have this whole new reality, and we have these new businesses that I'll call iTaxi. Uber, Lyft, to me it's just a taxi. You use your phone as a mini computer connected to the internet. So I have an iTaxi. Well, they're not supposed to call them taxis because all these regulation things. It's ride sharing or ride hailing or something. I'm like, I don't know what that is. I know what a taxi is. And it's remarkable. It's remarkable what Uber and Lyft and iTaxi is doing. How many people here have taken an Uber or Lyft before? Almost all of you. So you know what it's like to open up an app and pretty much have a ride within 5 minutes and go wherever you want to go directly. But the problem with this is it's expensive. So it's about $2 a mile, maybe a little less, but if I go up to Sherman Oaks, I'm looking at a $56 round trip ticket on an Uber or Lyft. Sorry. But here we are at this time where we can, you know, you can do car sharing where you walk up to the car, put in your PIN code, and start the car. We have the ability to change vehicles in less time it takes for you to see the light. You get to a red light, and how long? 2 minutes before it's green? In that amount of time, we can change a vehicle. And there's car sharing, bike sharing, and scooter sharing. And we can also now bring everything to us. I'd like to see the reality TV show if somebody decides to not leave their house for a year. They're just going to bring everything to them. So we kind of live in this world now where we have the car to go to these places and have the dentist 10 miles away, or we stay at home. And my talk's about something in between, a halfway, the neighborhood. Now, autonomous vehicles, Larry was at Volvo. I'm not going to talk that much about autonomous vehicles. They're amazing. They're coming, but they are not going to simply just magically solve our problems. If we're all driving cars that are too large, a self-driving car is not going to make that much better. So if we have someday, like all of us in the next 3 years, you're going to come to a four-way stop sign, you're going to look to your right, and there's going to be no one driving that car there. And you're going to go like, holy cow. It'll be the first, it'll all happen to us. You remember where you were in 9/11 when that towers went down? You'll remember when you see your first car with no one in it drive up and wait for you to go across. And then at some point you'll see more of them, and then you'll ride in them and you'll think they're amazing because these master computers are controlling the car. But at someday, people aren't gonna give a crap about any of it. It's like an airplane. That's a small neighborhood traveling in an aluminum tube with wings at 550 miles an hour, 5 miles above the Earth's surface, and they're up there looking at their iPads, drinking orange juice, and snoozing, and nobody gives a crap that that's what they're able to do. We will move past the amazement of self-driving cars someday. So here's quiz two. Can anyone figure out the words that are missing? Well, I'll answer it for you. A design tool. So the last paradigm of new transportation was the car. And when Henry Ford invented the Model T, the average American never went more than 25 miles from where they were popped out of mom's legs, where they were born. They never went more than 25 miles in their entire life. But with the car, we created the suburbs, where 60% of us now live. So the car became a design tool for reshaping the urban form. Quiz number three. So everything mobility and transportation, trillions of dollars, all the car companies, public transit, everybody, connectivity, Facebook, Google, all that. What's the word above it? It's all about access. So here's LA County. If we look at your cars from the helicopter, they're all like rectangles, right? They're all kind of the same size. You got 6.5 million cars here. Rolling rectangles. And it's a monoculture. And the thing is when you have a car society that has these cars where you can get in out of your, like you have a house in Mar Vista and you open your garage, if we just thought about the pavement as waterways, and your car was a little boat, you could take your little boat out the driveway and the boat down the street on the water, and you have 40 some odd million miles of little boatways across the country. You can take your car all the way to a driveway in Minnesota. It's fantastic, it's amazing. But it's a monoculture, and a lot of times people go like, well, what's the next monoculture? What's the way the future's gonna be? But we really think it's gonna be a lot of smaller solutions, not one big one thing controlling everything. So don't look for another monoculture. The other part of it is when you're sitting on traffic, Only 5% of the cars have to come off the freeway, and speeds will go up 50%. We don't have to move all of society to a non-car reality. You move 10% of the people into something that uses less space, 20%, you're going to start seeing the freeways here move like they did, you know, 30 years ago. So here's the crux of it. I call it the guy sitting on the left and he's alone. I call it the left alone syndrome. So a commuter in LA is usually 1.1 people per car. So that's a 20% load factor. And my friend, I said, how do you make a video of this? He goes, just show someone going to the beach with five beach chairs. Open up their five beach chairs like that, sit in one. The next person comes with five beach chairs, sits in one, and you just see the beach fill up with beach chairs. But if you run United Airlines, you're the CEO of United Airlines, how long can your airline fly at a 20% load factor? 1 week, and then you go out of business. So this is what we're doing. We're now in the internet age. We're in the age when you can get what you need, when you need it, right size it, don't get too much, get your insurance just for how you drive, customize it, don't have all this extra stuff you don't need it. But look at the freeways here. Everyone's driving around with pretty much, and not everyone, some families need that big vehicle all the time. But a lot of people don't. And when you look at a car, it's 30,000 parts. So using that to go a mile to get a coffee, you know, that's like going out and getting a shotgun because there's a roach in your house. Like, you know, it is total overkill. So my whole thing is about splitting now, moving from a monoculture of cars into two types of vehicles, two categories, one that's the size you know, and one that's smaller, and it's a smaller thing that you drive something bigger or somewhat smaller, or you ride in something bigger or you ride in something smaller. And this is my fantastic video that I found on the internet of cell splitting. So I'm trying to take the automobile monoculture and split it into two different size vehicles. Not in your average transportation movie. So the vehicles you have now, mostly, I call them fast, heavy vehicles. Cars, SUVs, minivans, pickup trucks, the delivery trucks, even the buses are there and the light rail trains, anything that basically can go up to 70, 80 miles an hour, it's a fast, heavy vehicle. The new category is the light, low speed mode. And that is something that is a pedal bicycle, and we want more pedal bicycles more than anything. And then other kinds of smaller electric vehicles, and then also a new type of local shuttle. But this is the key to what I'm going to talk about today is light, low speed modes, fast, heavy vehicle, two categories. And how can you redesign Los Angeles with two categories of vehicles and not one? So basically, if I use a tier system, the local vehicles are tier one, the cars we have are tier two, and that 500 mile an hour airplane is tier three. And then if Elon Musk is here, Elon, are you here? He would say, Dan, I think you forgot one. It's like, oh yeah, Elon, four to go to Mars. But what we've been doing in LA and a lot of places is we're basically trying to get people on bikes, and bikes take effort. And that's partly why they're great, because you work out. But getting people out of cars for bikes is a huge step. People don't all want to get on a bike to go around and get a jug of milk, you know, some milk a mile away. So I'm all about easy transportation that's smaller, because when it's easy and fun, I think someone might leave their car behind for a smaller, easy vehicle. Now, I started another company in 2006 and then raised $2 million, and then there was a thing called the economic collapse, which wasn't good timing for me. But we were doing the small, easy vehicles, and nobody basically would listen to me. No, almost nobody. But to see these little scooters come out is exciting, because this started 2 years ago in Santa Monica, and within 2 years, you have 38 million rides. So people do like easy vehicles. So here's the light, low speed modes. Bikes are best, and we want them more than anything.
But there's all kinds of little vehicles that fit in the LLM category. Some you might not know yet, some not are in production. And the thing about a light, low-speed vehicle is the safety is not only based on the vehicle, it's about the environment where it travels. So if I give you a small little light, low-speed vehicle and you go out to Venice Boulevard, you're like, yikes, get me off this thing. It's because of the environment. And part of what we can do as people is change that environment. The streets of Culver City are owned by the citizens. You don't have to let Uber drive down your streets if you don't want to. You don't have to keep the streets in the same shape that they are if you don't want to. This was the little vehicle that I designed years back. This is one of our customers. He's had his in Santa Monica for 14 years. He drives on Lincoln Boulevard. He goes up to 35 miles an hour with it. He bought it and had two cars in the family, his wife and his son. And then they sold one car, and then they sold the second car. And this, they've had it for 14 years. It's an interesting digression for me right now, is his son has now just entered college. All of his son's friends are looking at their cell phones with GPS in Santa Monica, like, where are we? Where are we going? And the kid who grew up in the back of my little vehicle knows all the time where he is in Santa Monica. It's pretty interesting. So there's other little vehicles coming. But these vehicles are available today. Not many of these Chinese lower price ones are coming here. There's about 2 million low-speed vehicles made in China now every year, but the Chinese don't see a market here because we're CLA with 2% bikes, and where do I drive them? But there are vehicles that are very inexpensive, and you know, someday you might go to the Honda dealer and say, well, I might take this Civic, or let me have 10 of those. But I will tell you, in LA, there's work being done to look at how small vehicles fit, but even though I designed a two-passenger side-by-side vehicle, it takes a lot of space. So I'm a bit more of an advocate these days for a neighborhood vehicle being a tandem seat. And here's a version of that. Here's quiz number four. Which famous transportation person said this? As we say, Elon is really good at thinking big, but not so good at thinking small. But the other part of this is the shuttles. We have this ability that not to have a small vehicle to get to your neighborhood mobility center or to the local stores. This is just a quick. This is a quick video by Toyota. Okay, so after all my many years of doing these small vehicles, there's two basic things that are really important to start right-sizing transportation in LA County. One is the safe travel corridors. If there's not going to be a safe environment for these small vehicles, nobody's going to use them. The second thing that I've always wanted to do, and it's been hard to do it until now, is how do you get a small vehicle into someone's house, but that's not an additional vehicle? Like if you're a two-car house and here's your neighborhood vehicle, it's now you have three vehicles to deal with. I've wanted the small vehicle to come and replace a car. And so to do that, it takes the kinds of ideas that I'm going to show you now going forward, which is how to create a way to not have to own that second car. And I also need you to kind of become a dreamer now. Like here's a beautiful car from 1970. The same year, there was a designer in Italy designing this vehicle. Because a show car, you just don't worry about the constraints. You just basically think, what do you want to make? Maybe it's not manufacturable. Maybe it won't even drive down the street. It's just to show your idea. But we don't do that enough in urban mobility and solving cities' problems. We don't think, you know, when I show you some new ideas, you don't have to go like, well, is Uber going to provide that? Or does the city? Like, we don't have to worry about that right now. So my solution, I call GoPoint, which is a proposal for a new type of a hybrid public-private transit network that uses these small vehicles. But to go into GoPoint, the first thing is you have to think about urban densities. Too many transportation conferences, people don't talk about the differences between New York City and Torrance, California. You know, in downtown San Francisco, I call it a thick city, like a thick steak. And thin city, public transit just hardly works in thin city. And, you know, LA County, and look at the valley, or, you know, you're in a corridor here from Culver City to downtown LA, it's a little denser than thin city. But going south or south central LA or down into Orange County, I mean, most of it is thin city. And so I started working in 2004 with CalSTART out here. I showed up to do, it was called the Clean Mobility Project, and I said, let's call it First Mile, we'll do first and last mile. And this is in 2004, because I saw the need for these little vehicles to help people get to transit. And the thing is, if I live in Pasadena and I need a little electric bike to get to transit, and it's going to take me to Torrance someday, I might need the electric bike in Torrance to go the last mile. You need a network. Now, to make Uber and Lyft cheaper, it's kind of using the hub and spoke model. The cheapest way you can travel on Uber is Uber Pool, is if you walk to the meet point. What is it that they have not done yet? They have not said, what about not walking? What if we use small vehicles to get to the place where you meet that ride? And instead of a car, maybe we have a van. And instead of going one way to Sherman Oaks for $28, it's now $3. You have 10 people in it. And so here's my quick video of that. Here's a van showing up, but this could be the light rail train. This could be a regular Uber driver connecting that transportation across LA with that first and last mile. I mean, it's almost worth watching that again. I mean, they're only proposing walking right now, but small vehicles can get you to a type of a transit where you're riding with what I'll call a group mobility vehicle. So, what I'm talking about is LA not creating 10 mobility hubs. I'm talking about LA County creating probably close to 300 mobility hubs. And they will ultimately get integrated with LA Metro and the train system, but they can also be an Uber Lyft type van that's not gonna take you, like when I get on a bus, it stops every block and someone gets in and puts cash in it. This van would take you from your neighborhood, if I'm going to Torrance, it'd take you straight down to Torrance with 8 other people. Because it's like a new evolution of the Uber Lyft model. And I should have an airport here, because this is how we travel today. We drive a car, a tier two vehicle, to an airport, which is a mobility hub, and we get in a tier three vehicle, 500 miles an hour to Chicago, we come down and we get in a tier two vehicle. And I'm just shrinking the whole thing down with tier one and tier two. But let's keep designing. I don't want to get in a van like Super Shuttle. Why don't we start having public transit that has your own personal space, like a pod you sit in? Why don't we have transit that gives you privacy where you can make phone calls? People love their cars to listen to their music and have their privacy. So we can basically start imagining transit in a new way. I mean, this may, what I'm about to show you may look a little too far, but remember, 10 years from now, we're not all going to be looking at our phones. There's a whole new paradigm of spatial computing and the new interface coming, and whether we have goggles on or glasses or whatever it's going to be, we're going into a new dimension, and that can be a part of that. So, but you can start with vans just with 8 seats in them. And so a mobility hub could look like this, or it could just be, it could just be a part of a parking lot where the van shows up and you maybe want to store your electric bikes or your things. So these hubs could be very light, very inexpensive, but it's just where tier one vehicles are going to store and get on a tier two ride across town. And maybe Lyft will make a limo, but the basic idea is a, basically a precept. So you could use lots of different ways to go locally and lots of different ways to go from hub to hub. It could be a monorail, it could be a light rail, it could be a van, it could be a car, it could be Elon's tunnels. I'd rather put small vehicles in Elon's tunnels than big vehicles. So here's a picture of the whole trip. Electric bikes converging on a van, van taking them right to the exact area of town they want to go. And they ride to their destination. They're doing this in Europe with bikes and trains, and the bigger thing is the coverage of the bike, and it's very successful now. So what I'm going to show you is a sketch of LA with lots of hubs. Now, the locations would be different, of course, and maybe the scales differently, but like thin city, maybe the valley's very thin city. You know, to me, it's like blood. You know, we had urban sprawl from the car, and it's like blood. Now, we want to clot the blood. We want to turn these into not 2% bike neighborhoods. We want to turn these into 25% bike neighborhoods, 25. We want more people to shop in these towns. We want to create LA into a place of amazing network of village kinds of neighborhoods. Okay, so to get this started, like, I can't probably have bike sharing at every little one of those circles you just saw. So let's think about vehicles on vehicles, car ferries, bikes on shuttles, on buses. So maybe a way to start is carry your electric bike on the back of the van. So you don't have to have the shared service waiting for you. But we can do all kinds of things. It's just a matter of envisioning it. So this is a crude video, but it just shows you an ugly strip mall and how it would transform from this first go point station. That's go point. So the idea here is you could take a 5-minute break before the second half, or you want me to just keep going? Break? All right, 5-minute break.